There are some things far more frightening than death.
Yes, the rhythm, the rebel. Without a pause, I'm lowering my level. The hard rhyme, where you never been, I'm in. You want styling? You know it's time again. D, the enemy, telling you to hear it. They praise the music, it's time to play the lyrics. Some say no to the album, the show. Bum rush the sound I made a year ago. I guess you know, you guess I'm just a radical. Not on sabbatical, yes, to make it critical. The only part of your body should be part of it too. Pair the power on the hour from the rebel to you.
Hey, yo, Chuck, man, I don't understand this, man. Yo, you got to slow down, man, you're losing them. Radio.
JP, I like how you decorated the place tonight.
Ah,
Are we celebrating Empire Day?
No, this is just my everyday. This is how the house looks. This is
we are broadcasting from JP's kitchen, and it's decorated like a 10-year-old boy's birthday party.
That's right. I really wanted to set the stage for our hard-hitting point counterpoint dissection of Star Wars Rebels.
That's right. We're talking Rebels tonight. The third and final time that we will be talking about Rebels Season 1.
And this is kind of what I imagine the battleground really looking like. It's a 10-year-old's birthday party.
Streamers and mm-hmm. birthday cake and tablecloths that are all Star Wars.
All of these things play into the some of my points and counter-arguments.
I have to ask you, JP, because I'm curious.
Yes.
How in the world did you ever find Star Wars merchandise?
You know, it's bizarre. I go to Target.
Yes.
And there is a Target, like a Star Wars section in Target. The amount of Rebels toys is very few.
Yes.
And in fact, the most prominent Rebels toys I found at that Target was, you know, those little guys they're making? Those little, like, Army Men type Star Wars toys?
Yeah.
But they kind of mix them in with, like, so you get some, like, an Agent Kallus, but you also get a bunch of clone troopers.
Sure, because that makes sense.
It's kind of like a random mishmash of stuff.
Sure.
And that seemed to be what was the most. That and the 12 inches of, like, those 12-inch doll guys.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like your Ezra.
Or
10 inches.
Yes, 10 inches, yeah. 12 inches.
12 inches on a good day. But, yeah, and not a lot of real true action figures for them.
I got to say that, like, My impression of the popularity of Star Wars Rebels, the TV show, was really biased by the amount of lack of merchandise out there on the toy shelves.
Agreed. Now that said, then I go a little ways across town.
Yep.
To a party supply store.
Okay.
Very efficient party supply store that's like all color coded, and they have an entire row of just like 10-year-old boys and girls licensed product party stuff. Right on the end cap is Star Wars.
Yes.
But not Star Wars like you thought. Like, not Star Wars like
Luke Skywalker, Darth Vader. Kenobi.
Straight up Rebels.
Really?
Whole end cap full of Rebels stuff. We got Rebels napkins. We got Rebels paper plates we're eating pizza off of right now. We got Rebels plastic cups that we're drinking our beer out of. We got Rebels tablecloth, Rebels streamers. I could have had more Rebels stuff.
Nice.
Could have some Rebels noisemakers.
I was reading up on the interview that StarWars.com did with Dave Filoni.
Mm-hmm.
Dave Filoni has added some generations to our thoughts on how many Star Wars generations there are.
Interesting.
He says that there's a OT generation, myself. Okay. There's a prequel generation.
Okay.
There's a Clone Wars generation. There's a Rebels generation, and there will be a Force Awakens generation.
Okay.
I think he's combining it, but in a way
he's inflating his own
Well, I think
place
what
in the
he's
world.
Saying is like there's entry points.
Well, yeah, I understand that, but what I'm saying is like I think he's kind of that's sort of inflating himself a little bit if he's saying the Clone Wars and Rebels are two separate entry points. Well, guess what? The OT took place over a course of 6-7 years, right?
You know, I got to say like as much as I love the Clone Wars.
Yeah.
I don't think that's an entry point. I think that
I don't believe it is.
I think
that's
Clone
a weird
Wars
kid.
Time has come and gone.
Clone Wars?
I think so.
Yeah.
For the TV show. I mean, I think, I don't think people are really going back to it as much as we tell them they should.
Oh, I think it's a great show, and I think anyone who's into Star Wars is, they might very well go back to it.
Right.
But I don't think it's the zeitgeist. I don't think it's much like listening to Beatles music.
That's right.
You know, it's still fun. It's still good.
JP?
Yes.
Two things.
Okay.
I edit the our show every week.
Yeah.
And I've decided that there should be a drinking game, SW Dog drinking game.
Okay.
And folks at home, every time we say the word zeitgeist,
oh no,
you need to take a shot.
This is what you get when you edit the shows. Okay, I get it.
I think I say zeitgeist on every episode.
Well, you know, we're talking about something that's very directly tied to the zeitgeist.
That's right. Zeitgeist. Oh, gotcha. Drink.
Yeah, we should figure out some other ones of those.
That's right.
There's a bunch of those.
Secondly, JP,
mm-hmm.
Who are we?
Oh, God damn it. My name's JP.
I am Ron.
Together we unite and form
Delusions of Granular.
That's right. That's GRANULAR.
.com if you want to find us on your the interwebs.
Yeah.
Also, you can find us at facebook.com/SWDog.
Don't forget Twitter.
Twitter at SWDog77. We throw the 77 on there because, well, that's when Star Wars came out.
And punk rock. Coincidence?
No, punk rock came out before that.
It's proto-punk and there's post-punk.
That's a different podcast altogether.
Oh, maybe.
All right.
You know what? Why don't you call us and give us your opinion on the interrelated
questions of... When punk came out?
Yeah, of punk and Star Wars and... let us know at 651-337-9364. That number, once again, is 651-33-SW-DOG. Feel free to call and just leave a message, and we'll address on the show if you feel good about it.
That's right. Or email us at swdog77@gmail.com.
We mean that.
Yeah. Give us emails.
You know, these aren't platitudes, guys. This isn't like when, you know, your mom says she loves you or something. This is real.
Yeah. Talk to us. Join the conversation, because we have a lot to talk about Star Wars, but, you know, we know you guys have a lot to talk about Star Wars, too. So, come on. Join the conversation. We're not mean. We won't attack you.
Yeah.
Well, JP might, but... Oh. And you can find us always on iTunes.
Beloved iTunes.
You can subscribe to us there or on Stitcher. And if you are kind, please leave us a review. If you're not kind and you don't like us, leave us a review anyway. We don't care. We just want reviews.
Yeah.
But more importantly, if you like us and you know other people that listen to podcasts and like Star Wars, tell your friends.
Yeah.
Right?
Sure. You know what? Why don't you have a little SW Dog party, get a couple friends together, have some drinks, and just put on the old SW Dog and give it a listen.
That's right. That's right.
Actually, don't do that. I've tried to listen to podcasts with friends.
Yeah, it doesn't work.
It's always awkward for me. It's a very personal experience.
Do you listen to us? Like, do you listen to us with friends? Because that would be awkward.
Yeah. I invite people over. And I get out chips and stuff, and they're like, oh, we're going to watch the game? I'm like, no. No. We're going to listen to the podcast.
Listen to me. And you're, like, actually, like, mouthing the words.
Yeah.
As you're speaking them on the podcast.
Yeah. I mean, that's how I like to do it.
This is where I made that racist joke.
We edited it out. Speaking of politically incorrect things, Ron.
Yeah.
On our part, at least, there is a new LGBT character in Star Wars.
That's right.
Forthcoming.
That's right. There's going to be, in canon, a gay or lesbian character. We're not entirely sure. Or transgender, I guess. Could be anything.
Yeah, or bi.
Right. So that's going to take place in the next novel that comes out.
Not Tarkin, but that's out.
Tarkin's out. Heir of two... The Jedi?
Yeah, that's the Luke Skywalker one.
Something of the Jedi? Yeah. Heir, I think it's heir to the Jedi.
Every time you say it, I think heir, like heir message. Like,
yeah, it's
incorrect.
It's kind of a dumb title.
Heir of the Jedi.
But that's out. Okay. I haven't read it. I didn't finish Tarkin. I'm kind of falling behind here.
Really? Yeah. It's funny, like I felt like we had so long to for these books to come out, and now we're on the eve of
just like churning them out.
Third or fourth book. Mm-hmm. So, anyhow, so there's going to be an LGBT character.
In the Darth Vader...
Lords of the Sith.
Yeah, the buddy picture.
Yeah,
that they're,
the gay prison romance.
That's right.
Picture.
That's right. Palpatine and Darth Vader flee prison with a
sexual innuendo.
Ambiguous person.
Yeah.
So when does that come out? I'm not entirely sure. You know what? It's probably coming out like next month.
Yeah, it's coming out very soon. Google will help you find out that. So I guess the bigger question here, what you raised to me was, is it really such a big deal to be LGBT in the Star Wars world when you have like Hera and Kanan?
That's the thing.
Interspecies?
I don't know how they're going to address this because there hasn't really been male-female regular heterosexual romances. Like, all we've really had is Han and Leia.
Yeah,
and now we're having Hera and Kanan, but that's really played pretty vaguely.
Well, yeah, right? Yeah.
And all of a sudden they're introducing this other character that all of a sudden their sexual orientation is going to be, like, addressed. Like, it seems kind of like they're putting the cart before the horse.
I feel like there's going to be a lot of shirts and stuff where, you know, there's a Han's shot first shirt.
Yeah.
Like, there's going to be, like, a C-3PO, like C-3PO was LGBT first.
Oh, like, I thought you meant, like, by shirts you were going to be, like, you know, Darth Vader is in his room with his shirt off and the guy catches him and is like...
I don't know what kind of shirt that is, Ron.
I don't know. It seems like a weird book to be like, yeah, we're going to have some kind of homosexual character.
I think that's kind of awesome, though. It's like, here's the book we've all been waiting for. It's the Darth Vader book where him and Emperor hang out. And guess what? There's gay stuff.
Is it one of them?
Yeah.
Is it Palpatine? Palpatine's gay?
You know, that would make... I would be shocked if the first honestly out-and-out gay character they had in Star Wars turned out to be the ultimate villain.
What if it's... Yeah, that would be bad.
That would be a misstep.
That's almost as bad as making a stormtrooper a black guy.
Oh.
Right? I mean, they took heat for that a little bit.
I didn't understand that controversy at all. I still don't.
Well...
Not because I see the world in, like, colorblind glasses, but just because well, why... What?
I know. Yeah. I don't know. But, yeah, it seems weird. It seems like a weird story. Like, all of a sudden, it's like, yeah, this can be a thing. Like, okay. Like, I don't know. Like, as I was reading the EU back in the 90s, I feel like there was, like, connotations that Mara Jade was, you know, kind of a little bit of a lesbian at times.
I have not read all the EU... But I believe in my heart that there is a lot of LGBT representation towards the latter third of the EU's lifespan.
Sure. I would say, yeah, I mean...
Yeah.
There's a lot of, well, now legends, a lot of ground that was covered there. More ground than you and I together have covered, you know.
Yeah.
So, folks, if we're correct in our assumption that they've already... had a, I can't even do the acronym,
LGBT.
LGBT. They've already had an LGBT character in the Star Wars universe via the EU. Let us know.
Well, I saw a lot of comments in the article that we were reading today where, that were just like all caps, like, Bryn Lahr! Like all, like, you know, like where it's just like,
Really?
Seems like it was some character's name.
Really?
I didn't know.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we'll have
to bother to Google it for the show.
We'll have to do our research on that.
Yeah. Maybe that can be a new feature. The LGBT corner.
We're outing
Star Wars characters. Outing Star Wars characters. I think that's a good idea. All right. We'll look for more of that coming up. What else? What did we keep the house cleaning? What else we got today? You know what? I just heard from you that there is an arc light. Coming here to Chicago.
Oh, that's right. There's an arc light. Yeah, so folks, as any good Star Wars fan would be doing, we're now in March. We have some 290-some days until the release of The Force Awakens.
I feel like we've been saying 290-some days forever.
Well, it's because we've only said it like on the last two podcasts.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's been 2 weeks.
But like any good Star Wars fan, we're already planning ahead for where we're going to see The Force Awakens.
Yeah, you know what? I'm actually starting to shift now. Now that you, like, you brought it up, I'm starting to shift into this like Phantom Menace thing. I'm like, let's fucking, let's do it. Let's plan it. Let's like
plan it out, man. We gotta like, get the tents. Gotta
use up a year's worth of PTO.
Exactly. Exactly. So we are, as always, we're broadcasting from Chicago.
Undisclosed Chicago location.
That's right. And we just found out that Chicago is receiving a ArcLight theater. I've been to an ArcLight theater in California. It's a wonderful theater experience. Mm-hmm. It's assigned seating, so you buy a ticket. They ask you where you want to sit, and yep. then you actually you can pick where you want to sit, and then they give you a ticket with an actual seat number.
Now I know the IMAXs, the downtown IMAX, Navy Pier does that too.
Sure.
So,
but this is just like, this is an IMAX. This is just kind of a regular theater going experience. Also, the benefit of an ArcLight, no commercials.
Really? No trailers?
No commercials. No trailers, no commercials.
No trailers.
Yeah, I believe so. I may be wrong about that, but I do remember when I went to the ArcLight in California. I didn't realize I was sitting in someone else's seat because I didn't know there was assigned seating. So somebody asked me to move because I was sitting in their seat.
You're like, fuck off, buddy.
Yeah, I'm like from Chicago, man.
Yeah.
We don't do it this way in the Chi-town.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're like, yeah, well, whatever, you're still in my seat. I'm like, okay. but right before the movie started, an employee of the ArcLight came into the front of the theater, announced the movie. Not only announced the movie, but it was like who directed it. Who, like basically gave the basic credits of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Asked politely in person to everyone to shut off their phones.
Nice.
Which is like just like a really nice touch, right?
Oh, yeah.
Being asked by a human instead of like being asked by, you know.
Yeah, with that shitty graphics going. Like,
yeah. And then the movie started like instantly. Yeah, I don't think there was trailers.
Nice. You know, and also, what the presentation you're describing makes me feel like I'm not going to get shot to death in that theater. You know what I mean?
Totally, totally. Because it's like, I mean, I went to the ArcLight in California like maybe 10 years ago, and it was like twice the price of a ticket. Like, if a gunner's going to come into a theater, they're not going to come into that theater because it's going to cost them twice as much.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Right?
Yeah.
The economy of scale here.
Perfect. That's well, I think we know where we'll be here in 290-some-odd days.
That's right. We'll be camped out in the middle of December in Chicago at the ArcLight.
Oh, my God. That's we're just coming out of a horrible winter.
That's
and now
right. We're already planning ahead for the next one.
Oh, God. Okay.
All right, folks. I think that covers all of our homework. We need to get into our big discussion this week.
Oh, that's right. So we've been teasing this out for, well, pretty much better part of 3 months. Well,
yeah, I mean, this is the episode that's been in the making since
our first episode.
Pretty much, yeah.
Back when we were a young podcast, back in the heady days of summer 2014.
That's right.
When we were talking about this new show that was going to come out, Rebels.
That's right.
Season one has just wrapped. We have both seen it all. You have actually gone back and watched it a couple times.
I've watched, I've watched and rewatched the entire season, is in many episodes, multiple times.
Our longtime listeners, those of you who know who you are, you've heard it. You've heard the ups and downs. We've given periodic updates, but tonight we're going to dive into it and we're going to get granular.
We're going to get granular. Okay. Yeah, we're going to talk about the entire first season, so spoilers if you have not seen it. We are going to be talking about it. As always on SW Dog, we pretty much bulldoze right over spoilers.
Yeah, we don't talk about
it
enough anymore.
Yeah, we talk about it. If you haven't seen it, well, too bad. That's why you're listening to us, because we just talk about it.
Yeah. So we originally planned to do this episode in kind of a point-counterpoint thing.
Yeah. Because we did kind of fall on two sides of the coin.
That's right. The as far as
how we enjoyed the show.
Yep.
I being the Gen 1 OT fan.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna come out and say it. I fell head over heels by the end of the season. I was gaga over the show.
All right.
It ended very well for me. It gave me what I needed, and most importantly, it made me want to see season two right now.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I had a different experience. I had a lot of high hopes. Gen 2 fan here. And sometimes they were glimpsed, rarely met, and then sometimes they were spat upon. And
what's that, your expectations?
Yes.
Okay.
And by the end of it all,
don't give it out yet.
Yeah, I don't want to
give it out yet.
I don't want to give it out yet, but it was up and down. So basically, long story short, for the purposes of this conversation,
yes,
I will be taking the dark side, the Sith side, the negative. I will be pointing out the negatives.
Right. I will be taking the light side and pointing out the positives of the show, and kind of hopefully our two point of views will kind of reflect the point of view of fandom out there.
Yeah,
that the show has received.
One thing we don't do very often, someone's pointed out to me, is that acknowledge the listeners.
That's right.
And so, hey, listener out there, feel free to follow along.
That's right. So if you have some doubts about the show, or just outright didn't care for it, had problems about it, you're going to be following JP.
Hello.
To a certain point tonight. If you loved it, thought it was the best thing that happened to Star Wars since
sliced blue milk,
then you will be following my point of view tonight. So I guess we should start with the beginning. I know we've covered some of this before, but it started out with a extended long episode movie, so much is what they're calling it.
50-minute movie.
That's right. Called Spark of Rebellion. This is where we get introduced to our main characters, Ezra, Kanan, Hera, Sabine, Zeb, and lovable Chopper.
Yes, lovable Chopper.
So, I know we've spoke of our problems of this episode in the past, but having rewatched it and taking the entire season as a whole,
yes,
and taking it all into account, as I have rewatched all of this, I think it's a strong start to the show. I think it went probably 10 minutes too long. As much as I really am a fan of the show now, the Wookiees, the whole Wookiee plotline was not necessary. It was not addressed. I feel it was never addressed again in the rest of the season.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, like, they did this poor execution of Wookiees.
Yeah, and bizarre, because they'd already know how to do Wookiees. They did Wookiees in the Clone Wars pretty well.
Yeah.
Comparatively.
Yeah. But we got a good introduction to the characters. We saw that Ezra is kind of, living on his own, not abandoned, but his parents are gone. And we have this kind of group, family, crew, whatever you want to call them.
Surrogate family.
Yeah. That, they're out to kind of, their goal is to kind of wreak havoc on the Empire, which is taken over kind of the government of Lothal, which is main planet where Rebels takes place.
Ezra is a self-proclaimed orphan street urchin.
Yeah.
He's kind of looking out for his own interests.
Yeah.
He runs into these other guys who are also seemingly into their own interests.
Yes.
But are actually working for a larger cause, which throughout the season we'll find out more about.
Right. As the season rolls down, like, we find out that, like, certain characters are in the dark on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
As the viewer is kind of in the dark on some of this stuff, so are the characters. And I really feel that the first season did a really good job of kind of... it's a starting point. Like, things are not completely established yet. Like, we're just learning that there's a rebellion against the Empire. And for most of season one, the rebels that we're following aren't really even rebels. They're insurgents. They're terrorists, essentially, And
they call them insurgents.
They end up calling them by the end of the season insurgents.
Not even by the end. I think this was in the first four episodes they labeled insurgents. You've watched more than me, I guess.
Well, I mean, so Yeah, they may have actually called them insurgents, because...
I remember taking a keen eye on that, being like, whoa. Very coded language.
One of the things in rewatching the season that I found interesting was that I thought that it was going to kind of... I guess in hindsight, I thought, looking back on it, I thought it started pretty light, and it eventually got a little bit darker as it went on, right? Because right after the season premiere, the Spark of the Rebellion, we get Fight or Flight, which is kind of a goofy episode. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, Zeb and Ezra going off to on a mission to gather fruit, and they end up stealing a TIE fighter very recklessly.
Sure.
Right? It's kind of... like, there's no real consequence to the mission. There's nothing really happening other than, you know, we get to see Zeb and Ezra kind of bicker with one another and,
talk about Fight or Flight.
I'm sorry. I skipped one episode. But,
it's okay. I don't think we have to do a chronological thing. We don't need to make a list episode.
No, but...
I'm talking about holistically.
Sure. But I thought it was kind of a lighthearted episode, mm-hmm. right? But going back on it, like, the episode that came right before it was
Droids in Distress.
Droids in Distress, where we actually were introduced to the OT characters, R2-D2 and C-3PO.
And the PT character. Bail Ortega.
Bail Ortega, yeah.
Or Organa.
I was going to say, are we just going to, like,
always
reference him as Bail Ortega?
Sorry.
Because that's racist. Kind of.
But I like the political correctness angle we're going for today. Yeah. You know?
I still want to call him Bail Ortega.
Well,
yeah.
No. Listeners, right in.
But.
More racist comments.
Please. Yes, you're not talking about Asians enough. Please. Having rewatched this, I did not care for having R2-D2 and C-3PO show up so early into Rebels.
You were very anti that when it happened.
Yeah, but rewatching it and knowing what I know, that they're actually spies and that Bail Ortega had hired them to kind of check in on this insurgent cell.
They don't hire droids, you order them.
Well, but they were working for Bail.
Yeah.
Right?
How did he get a hold of those droids? I guess they're on the ship.
I mean, I guess Obi-Wan just ditched them, right? Yeah. He's like, yeah.
Like, I don't get those.
Padme's dying. I don't want these things. Here, take them. Well, no, in the end of Sith, Bail is like, and have their memories wiped.
Oh, that's right. Thank God.
Thank you, Rob. It all fits together.
Yeah.
Seamless. No problems there. No problems.
All seamless.
Move along. but watching it again, I was really kind of intrigued by the fact that, knowing what I know now, that they were, you know, spies. Like, I thought it worked well. I liked that R2 definitely knew exactly what was going on, and 3PO, he seemed to, he was playing along with it really well by being his usual 3PO self and kind of being clueless. But at the end, he's like, oh, no, I knew exactly what was going on. And, you know, we were watching out. We were keeping an eye on these rebels.
Okay. So I'm just going to, that's kind of covering off of the movie and the first two episodes, I'm just going to address a few things.
Problems?
A few problems.
Okay.
Right off the bat, we see something that's going to become symptomatic with the entire show.
Okay.
And that is... things that become part of the plot for no apparent reason other than that they remind people they're watching Star Wars.
Okay.
Number one, Wookiees.
Wookiees, yeah. Wookiees, that was a problem.
I mean, that adds
yes.
nothing.
The Wookiees did not add nothing. As much as I am defending the show, the Wookiee thing I didn't really need.
Yeah. It was didn't add anything. Very arbitrary. Yeah. And I get the idea, you know, it's the first episode and they aired it as a special. It was on ABC.
Right. And they were, you know, they were referencing Kessel Run,
mm-hmm.
or not the spice mines of Kessel, not the Kessel Run itself.
Yep.
You know, so.
And some of that makes sense. Like, you know, you gotta, you know, hey, it's Star Wars. You know, you want the parents watching with the 10-year-olds to be like, oh yeah, we're watching Star Wars. But, the Wookiees executed poorly.
Very poorly, yeah.
B, there's a lot of fun, fast-paced action in the original trilogy, which they're always referencing. But unlike in this show sometimes, they're trying to be very diplomatic.
Yes.
When held under scrutiny, pretty much everything in the OT holds up, like why they did certain things.
Sure.
Yeah, some things are a little shaky. Mm. But most things hold up, right?
Yes.
But in this show, it's a lot of stuff where it's like, why did we go here? Why did we do this? Why are those people there?
Sure.
What's that have to do with anything? So that's just something that's going to come up again and again throughout.
I completely agree with you. The Wookiees thing, it doesn't really have any consequence over the rest of the season, so that's where I'll just kind of go along with it.
Mm-hmm. Now, C-3PO and the droids, that question is...
well...
You feel like that was a... In rewatching it, that was worthwhile knowing there were spies.
Yes. It also established that Bail Organa is aware of what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Which plays out at the end of the season.
So, I think to do this properly, we might have to skip to the end to go back to the beginning.
Okay.
Kind of meet in the middle a little bit.
All right.
Because at the end, spoilers again.
Yes.
Bail Organa is, of course, revealed to be one of the leaders of the rebellion.
Yes.
There is a middle person that has been teased throughout the entire season, Fulcrum.
Yes.
Who Hera interacts with.
Yes.
Do you think this was a setup to make it look like maybe he was going to be Fulcrum?
I don't
know. Like, were they trying to throw a couple red herrings in
there?
I don't
think so. In watching some of the Rebel Recon behind-the-scenes episodes, I think they did one for each episode.
Okay.
And watching the one for the final episode, and maybe it was interviews with Filoni himself that I read, basically, they were... The creators of the show, Dave Filoni and crew, were very much impressed with the fans trying to figure things out and actually getting things correct. And what they did to kind of throw the fans off the scent was Fulcrum throughout the season is not always voiced by Ashley Eckstein, who is the voice of Ahsoka.
Okay.
Right? They actually use the different voice character in different parts of the season to kind of throw people off that maybe it isn't Ahsoka.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But the people that are, you know, going through the credits or what have you are kind of figuring out that that's Ashley Eckstein's voice.
Mm-hmm.
But they were purposely trying to throw us off but also give us hints. So it's a weird kind of situation. They're like, yeah, we want to, like, hint that Ahsoka is Fulcrum, but we also don't want people to get it as well. So, you know, we're throwing out hints, but also kind of throwing out fake hints as well.
Interesting. Yeah. Now, I realize now 30 minutes into the podcast that for anyone who hasn't actually watched the show or isn't familiar with Rebels and this is your first podcast, Rebels is taking place in between Revenge of the Sith and New Hope.
New Hope, yeah.
It's about 5 years before New Hope?
Yes.
On the planet Lothal. Yeah. Always on Lothal.
Well,
they
it's
leave.
Funny.
They
it's
leave.
Funny because having rewatched the entire season, they actually leave Lothal more times than you would think.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's supposed to be kind of based around Lothal.
Yes.
We don't this the rebellion thing. They're kind of a cell of a rebellion. We don't really know how it's all connected.
Right.
And they are facing off against the big bad, the Inquisitor.
They're facing off against the empire that is based on Lothal.
Yes.
And the empire that's based on Lothal. And the
empire outpost that's based
on
Lothal?
Yeah, it's like an empire outpost. It's kind of...
They have a training center there.
Well, is that...
Is that on Lothal?
I think it's on the Star Destroyer.
So, what's on Lothal?
Well, I think what Lothal is basically a typical planet that... is being overtaken by Empire rule, and it's kind of an inconsequential planet as far as we're being told right now. Like it's not a Coruscant. It's not, you know, it's not Dagobah or something like that. It's, mm-hmm. you know, it's just kind of a planet where people live and go through, you know, the daily life. It's not sparsely populated like Tatooine. It's not a forest planet. You know, people live on Lothal, right?
Yeah, it's a working class
planet. Yeah, it's kind of a working class planet, and it's, you know, the citizens are kind of like, okay, you know, the Empire is taking over. That's our government. You know, like, however poorly or well we're treated, we're just going to deal with that because we're just kind of like working class stiffs.
I got an impression that it was kind of like if, say, Tatooine is Arizona, then this is like Kansas.
Exactly.
And the difference being that, like, there's no organized crime of the Hutts, per se,
Doesn't seem like there's a lot of crime.
There is, but it's mostly based around the fact that the Empire is there, and now, and like, this black trade stuff happens wherever the Empire is.
Oh, yeah, you have Visago.
Yes.
Visago, which is an interesting character. He seems like, at the outset of the season, he seems like he's going to be the, what's his name from Clone Wars? Yeah, I'm drawing a blank on his name.
Hondo,
yeah. The Hondo of the series.
Yeah.
But Visago is really kind of... He's not a nice guy. Like Hondo in the Clone Wars, he was kind of a scoundrel with a heart of gold. You know, you saw, like, good points. So far, Visago seems just kind of like a dick.
See, I kind of disagree. I feel like that we saw at least one scene where... It seemed like he's kind of... I think that Hondo might have been a little more ruthless.
Really? I didn't see that.
Well, yeah, because Hondo is like actually willing to kill and all this kind of various stuff, whereas this guy, there's a point where they do the... where him and Ezra are making a deal, and he tells Ezra... It's a funny little bit, actually. It's towards the end of the season where, you know...
Well, it's a big deal.
Where he's got a... You know,
it's a big deal.
Where he's got to... bow, you know, it's like, oh, right. They make a deal, so I bow to you,
right,
and you bow to me,
right,
and but like Ezra doesn't know the protocol, so like he like bows down in front of him and like doesn't tell him what they're doing,
yeah,
and like Visago character is one of the devil characters from the
yes, he's a
cantina
Devorian,
yeah,
something like that,
yeah, Devilian,
yeah.
Devil man, so he's got like the horns and stuff, so he bows down in front of Ezra, and Ezra's, you know, kind of a like, young kid, and yes. He like just. Ezra just, like, doesn't know what to do, so he, like, touches his horn, and then, like, Visago, like, shakes up, and like, no, I bow, then you bow.
That was a funny scene.
And I was like, well, that seems to show there's some kind of honor system here, like, it's not just pure, you know, we haven't seen him do anything ruthless, what I'm getting at.
Well, we do. At the start of the season, the rebels kind of botch a delivery and actually bring the Empire down on Visago, and the rebel group that we're following, you know, they're hard up for money and they need supplies and that, and Visago kind of is like, look, you brought the Empire here, like, screw you guys, I'm not giving you money, like, well,
that's
sorry.
Not killing people though, I think we actually
no he's
saw
not
Hondo
killing
kill people.
Possibly. I don't remember him killing people, but I don't disagree with you. I don't know. I got, between the two characters, I think I was a little bit more, I found Hondo a little bit more likable, charming maybe.
Right.
Visago seemed a little bit colder. You know, there was that funny moment that you just described, but I did feel like, in context, the scene where Ezra makes the deal... Ezra kind of screws over the rebels for the future because he admits, you know, he basically confesses to Visago, who's, you know, a shady character, that he's a Jedi, and admitting that you're a Jedi during this time is not a good idea.
Yeah, it's a death sentence. Not only the Empire going to be after you, we know they're willing to hire bounty hunters, which will probably play out in season 2 or 3. And admitting that him and Kanan are both Jedi is valuable information.
Yes.
Now, so here's another one of my critiques, point number two.
Okay.
You kind of made the comparison between Hondo and Visago.
Yes.
Knowing that the mandate of this show is kind of expand the universe further somehow, this could have been Hondo.
It could have been Hondo, sure.
Could have been Hondo. So many times I look at the things especially when we get to the season finale and stuff. And I question, you know, there's that classic screenwriter's advice. You know, write a script.
Yes.
Look at the first 10, 20 pages, and then take them out. And then what's left, that's where you start your story. You know?
Sure.
Because, like, that was kind of the issue I had this whole season, was that the entire setup feels like setup. It's like, it feels like we're holding back. Like, well, I don't want to use Hondo because he could be used for something else. Well, I don't want to use, you know, Ahsoka because she was used for something else.
Sure.
You know? And
I mean, I hear what you're saying. Mm-hmm. I totally hear what you're saying. And I won't disagree with you. Like, as the season was unrolling, I felt that frustration.
Yeah. Right?
And folks, if you've been following along, if you're, you know, lucky enough to have Disney XD and were able to actually watch these on time, maybe you do feel that frustration as well.
Mm-hmm.
I had funny thoughts about this as I was rewatching this stuff. Lucas, the creator of Star Wars, I don't think he ever intended for his movies to be held under such scrutiny.
Oh, of course
as they've been held under.
Yeah.
You know? I don't think anybody would ever anticipate that. I mean, there's podcasts where they go through the movies minute by minute, you know?
Right. We talked about this at length, the idea that this was supposed to be, you know, a little money-making venture for his little art pictures.
Right.
Yeah.
So part of me is like, oh, just enjoy it for what it is and just, you know, move on. But rewatching it, and rewatching it especially to do this show, I got a different point of view from, you know, kind of holding it under more scrutiny.
Okay. No.
You know, like, certain things started to be more revealed to me as I'm watching this, you know. And I was glad it was Visago. I was glad that it was a new character. You know, a new character instead of just the same old characters. Because we've already seen R2-D2. We've already seen C-3PO. We're going to see Lando. We're going to see, you know, we're going to hear Yoda. You know, like, it's a small universe already. So, like, I don't need to see a Hondo. Right,
okay.
Visago, like, this is great. It's a new character. You know, it expands the underworld. You know, there's shady characters with hearts of gold. There's shady characters that don't have hearts of gold. Like, I'm fine with that. Like, I was impressed that they were able to introduce characters that became, as the season wore on, memorable. You know,
like who?
Well, Visago, for one.
Okay.
If we're going to go all the way to the end of the season, mm-hmm. the final shot of the heroes, we have many big reveals in that last episode, okay? Without going into what those reveals are, we'll get there. The final shot of our heroes is not the fan favorite character. The final shot of our heroes is the rebels that we just watched 15 episodes of. Okay. We see them all together and then it cuts to the Empire. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was kind of a cool thing. It's like, it's not ending on the fan favorite from the previous series.
Ah, yeah.
Right. It's like, no, this show is about this group of characters. This is the group that we're trying to make you care about, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And it's been a bumpy road. I'm not going to disagree that it's not been a bumpy road watching it,
right?
From week to week. But if you watch it, if you marathon it, it's going to hold up more, I think, than watching it week to week.
Hmm.
Right? Because we had a hiatus in there. You know, we had, you know, like, watching it week to week, in this day and age, that's not how TV works anymore. As much as it was, like, things are built, you know, like, there's a through line in all of these episodes, right?
Okay.
Right? It's not like Clone Wars where there was, like, you know, specific arcs for, you know, three or four episodes, and then you could go on to the next one. Like, there's kind of a through line throughout this entire series, and they kind of told one story in, you know, 15, 16 episodes, whatever this was.
Okay. Well, I think you hit on a good thing there. The characters. The characters have been trying to make us care about. Let's talk a little about them.
Okay.
So characters we're supposed to be caring about is the main core. Have we named everyone yet?
Hera, Kanan, the Jedi.
Yep. Hera's the Twi'lek.
Yes.
The little Twi'lek on her head.
The Twi'lek pilot, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Sabine. Ezra's a street rat that they adopt, basically.
Street rat.
Sabine is the Mandalorian artist.
Artist slash detonation.
Yeah, demo expert. Demolition expert.
Explosion.
Yeah.
Yeah, something. Yeah. She's into bombs.
Yes, and Zeb is the Lasat.
Yep, the not Wookiee. The last not Wookiee. Of his race.
Yeah, one of the last of his race. They actually.
Oh, did they make a key?
I didn't actually catch that. He's one of the last of his
race.
Oh,
good.
So we may actually run into a different one.
Good deal.
Yeah.
So, this has been an interesting melting pot. Visually, I thought that these characters all worked very well together as a unit. Mm-hmm. I thought they were designed very well to work together. Writing aside, there were some very unorthodox choices. Namely, that we still don't have backgrounds for most of these characters.
True.
We don't know anything about Hera.
True.
We know next to nothing about Sabine. We know almost nothing about Zeb.
Right.
I mean, the one, you know, Chopper's a droid, so whatever.
Yeah, right.
We really only know things about Kanan and Ezra.
Sure.
And even that's kind of vague. And I honestly thought I was going to go into this episode saying that was a big, like, point off. Like,
right.
Characterization.
Right.
But I disagree now. Because think about it. How much do we know about Han Solo?
Sure.
Like, almost nothing.
Well, let's... We're already 46 minutes into this episode. Let's get to the heart of it here.
Okay.
Right? We've done a couple Rebels episodes prior to this one, and we wanted to do another one because this really wraps up the season.
Yeah.
We've had our ups and downs with this show.
Okay.
Right? As we've gone along, I think we've kind of diverged on our feelings for this show. You've taken a little bit more of a negative view of it. I've taken more of a positive view of it.
Yes.
Ultimately, it finished big.
Okay, you know what? That's right. Let's just go ahead, hit the finishing mark, and then we'll come back and say what worked and what didn't work.
I think we have to do that, right?
Yeah.
It finished big, folks. Folks,
we've had a few long-running episodes.
If you're going to catch up on this, I will say this. I fell in love with this show. Fell in love with the show. The last three, maybe four episodes, it clicked for me. It clicked for me in a big way. And I'm saying this as the original OT Gen 1 fan. This is Star Wars. This is Star Wars in every way that we've grown to know Star Wars as OT fans. There's fast action, there's big twisting moments, there's, as I was talking to JP earlier today, there's a lot of quips between the characters as they're going through this fast action that feels very, very OT to me. The big moments are, they're big, they're really big,
mm-hmm.
right? There's actual consequences that happen. There's actual deaths that I never thought I would see in a Disney XD show. And I walked away as just like, okay, come on April, because that's when season two is going to get a preview, and I'm all for it. The way they left season one made me very excited about this show in general and what's going to come next.
Okay, so I obviously did not fall quite that glowing. Here's a few things.
Yes.
First off, a big teaser for the episode was called Who Falls? Basically doing the classic Marvel Comics thing of, this issue, someone dies.
Yes.
It's like, who is it? Is it going to be Kanan? Is it going to be Ezra? Is it going to be... Well, it turns out it's going to be the Inquisitor.
Yeah, the Inquisitor bites it.
So you believe that he died?
I believe that... I'll believe he died.
No body, no death. He falls into a ball of fire or something. By his own volition. Yes. He chooses to fall. Kanan has him, you know, kind of pinned.
There's a very... Very Phantom Menace... esque lightsaber battle between two light side Jedi. We'll call them force wielders. They're not Jedi,
but not force wielders like the force wielders from Mortis.
No, but I mean the whole
to make it confusing for them.
Yeah, the whole it's also confusing.
Kanan and Ezra are fighting.
I want to bring this up because I have an issue with this, or not an issue, but a point to make about this is Kanan and Ezra are guys that use lightsabers.
Right. Okay?
They're not Jedi.
Right.
Right? They're not Jedi, and they're battling the Inquisitor, who is not a Sith.
Right.
Okay?
That's a good point.
He's using a red lightsaber, the double lightsaber. That spins. Well... double lightsaber like Darth Maul, but with spinny action.
Which is why, because I actually reached the same
spinning point. Action is,
stupid.
It's a stupid point.
Right? At least they made a point of it being stupid in
this
episode.
They did make a point of it, right?
Yeah.
They pointed out the design flaw that in this stupid spinning lightsaber with the circle handle that Kanan is able to kind of point out the flaw and destroy it.
I will point out that this episode did exactly what you said with that, made me realize that these guys are two guys who can wield the Force who have lightsabers, who aren't Jedi, and they're fighting a guy who's had a lightsaber and is Force sensitive but is not a Sith.
Yeah.
In terms of that, that's why they have such goofy lightsabers.
They have goofy lightsabers, yeah.
But both these lightsabers have total design flaws. Because they're not real Jedi and Sith weapons.
True.
I'm okay with that. That was a good step in the right direction to make that okay. But my thing is, you're right. This scene's a total homage to the Phantom Menace.
Yeah, it's almost a ripoff. More than an homage.
And Darth Maul, we saw on screen get cut in half.
Yeah.
This guy's not even cut in half.
No, he falls through his fiery death.
And I don't know if you noticed, but this tablecloth, these cups... all these streamers, all this stuff has the Inquisitor's face on it. I don't think they're done with him.
Well, you better put this stuff in storage because it's gonna be worth money.
Yeah. Okay. So now my next big thing here, and this is just writing right off my notes.
Yeah. Please run off the negatives because I feel like I've been kind of the fanboyish person on this episode so far.
So consequence.
Yes.
No. One thing I find frustrating is people talk about dark as if it's a better thing. Hey, it went dark. Yep. Now it's good.
Yep.
And what they're really trying to say is now there seems to be some kind of level of consequence, whereas before there wasn't.
Yes.
So in terms of consequences, final episode. Final arc, Callus,
yes.
Remains.
Yes.
Not dead.
Yep. No, not dead.
We went to Mustafar.
Kinda has, I gotta say... The last we see of Callus with Tarkin kind of stepping off the shuttle and spoiler, Vader following behind him.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if this was intentional or not, but Callus has like a smug look on his face. Like this Vader guy, not that big of a deal. I was just like, I've watched this over and over again. I was like, that look on his face is just like... He points out that the Empire has weaknesses in it, and he's almost happy about it.
It's funny because I would almost say that it would be, if this was the first 8 episodes, I would say it was probably just shitty animation. Two episodes...
Oh, the animation got stepped up.
They definitely saved their entire budget for these last two episodes because the animation gets to Clone Wars level quality.
Yeah.
And they did really subtle things with character facial stuff in this.
Yeah.
There's a part where Hero, specifically I'm thinking where Hero is reprimanding Ezra and crew for like trying to capture, find Kanan.
Yeah.
That's totally stumbled here. And Zeb's in the background, like, making this face where it's kind of like, oh, like, don't get upset. Like, we're trying to get
right.
And I was like, very subtle.
There was a lot of subtle things. I noticed a lot of subtle things, kind of starting with the Lando episode, Idiots Array.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, Lando is kind of putting the moves on Sabine. And I started to notice her subtle facial gestures, you know, kind of being flattered by this guy, but also not taking him seriously because he's, you know,
scoundrel.
Yeah. Like, I was like, the animation's getting better. You know, like, I'm actually starting to feel the emotion of the characters through their facial gestures.
Hmm. Okay. So.
But keep going with the negatives because I have big redeeming positives here.
Okay. So basically what I'm saying is, what are the consequences? There's two characters who we didn't really know their names or care about them. They died. Everything else,
pretty much... The two Imperial guys that the Inquisitor...
Yeah.
Yeah. They have names. I don't know what they are.
Two guys. Yeah. What else?
I've looked them up. I've read their names numerous times. Still don't know their names.
So the final episode, we end up going to Mustafar.
Nope.
We go to Star Destroyer.
We go outside of Mustafar.
Star Destroyer hovering around Mustafar.
Yeah.
We don't actually go into Mustafar.
Yeah.
So why did we go to Mustafar?
Because that's where they were going to take Kanan for some type of torturous death.
But they tortured him on the Star Destroyer.
But this was going to be worse.
Yeah, whatever.
Drawn and quartered. I don't know.
Yeah, same as Wookiees. More stuff. Brought up for no reason but fan service. So the thing is here, what ultimately changes in the series?
What changes?
Yeah.
Okay.
They join the Rebel Alliance as a greater whole.
Well, before that.
Why couldn't we have started there?
Well, let's keep that point in mind
okay.
in case I get lost. Because I have kind of a roundabout way of summing up this series.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Or this season, at least. So, to start with, I will say this. I do believe that Filoni and the creators of the show did have to find their footing. You know, they came off of this successful Clone Wars that was also canceled prematurely.
And right? It was also funded by Lucasfilm when Lucas was in charge.
And Lucas was still there, you know, kind of guiding them. Right?
Supposedly it had some kind of crazy budget.
It probably had a crazy budget, but also, I mean, Lucas was there. Like, Lucas was with Filoni and, like, actually, like, coming up with story ideas with him, right?
In the writer's room, yeah.
Yeah, so, like, Lucas is gone, so this is the first time that the creators are kind of, like, off on their own. Okay, you know, do this. So, you know, this is not as long of a season as Clone Wars ever was. Clone Wars usually went about 26 episodes.
Mm-hmm.
This was, you know, 15 or 16. I'm not sure how we're counting that first episode, if it was one episode or two.
Yeah, they had a stronger launch because they actually had a theatrically released movie and stuff. Yeah.
So we've covered less ground with less time, right? And we've had, you know, kind of – I give the creators credit for kind of finding their footing in less amount of time than they had with the Clone Wars. They had a little bit more time to find their way, and they had a little bit more guidance from George. So I kind of forgive them for all that. As far as I'm concerned, they found their way by the end of it. But along the way, I mean, these weren't, you know, prior to the last three or four episodes, I don't feel like they were wasted episodes. We got to learn that Kanan, and this is subtle, but Kanan was a Padawan whose master was killed in Order 66.
Mm-hmm.
So he's not really a full Jedi, and he has his doubts about training Ezra as well as, you know, who he is as a Jedi, right? And again, this is subtle. I don't think you really get this as you're going along, but I think it it's well documented by the end of the season, mm-hmm. that is kind of his motivation and his reluctance to train Ezra. You know, it's kind of frustrating as you're going, but by the end it's like, oh yeah, okay, that's why he's doing that. Okay. For me, the big turning point of this entire season was Kanan getting captured by the Empire.
Okay. Well, okay. Yeah, that's 3 episodes before the end.
Right. But not just like the big story, but the big theme of the season. Okay?
Okay.
Because you have Kanan, who's not really a Jedi and really by no rights has the skills to train another Jedi, let alone Ezra, who's, as we've learned from Yoda, too old to begin the training. Right? Mm-hmm. Ezra's old. You know, Ezra's like 15 or 16 years old.
Yeah.
Right? That's way older than the younglings of, you know, Attack of the Clones.
Way older than Anakin.
Right. So he has no right to be training Ezra. Ezra really has no right to be trained by a, you know, a half Jedi at the most. Right? Mm-hmm. And these two, by no means, are Jedi, okay? And they are by no means Jedi because of this one thing that, like, it clicked for me big time, is they have attachments, right? We've learned in the prequels, we've learned in the Clone Wars, that to be a Jedi is to not have physical attachments.
Right.
Right? Kanan gets captured. Hera is like, well, we have to let him go for the greater good. You know, one man down, we can't there's bigger things going on. We one man is not worth being rescued to, you know, sacrifice the greater good, the greater cause.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And Ezra is like, no. Kanan is our friend. He's a family member, right?
Right. Emotional attachments, yeah.
He has an attachment.
Yep.
Right? He has an attachment. Like, here's two guys that, like, they don't know the light side from the dark side because they don't know. And they're skirting on the dark side.
And I think there's definitely something to be said, too, about Ezra's around the age that Kanan was when he lost his master.
Yeah.
I mean,
like, and Ezra lost his parents, you know, like Anakin. Anakin, you know, was detached from his parents. Like, they're I would be highly disappointed if season 2 comes around and they don't play up on these themes. Mm-hmm. You know, Ezra is attached to Kanan. Kanan is attached to Hera. Like, they have, you know, emotional attachments. That's not a Jedi way. As we've learned from, you know, 60-some episodes of the Clone Wars and the prequels. Like, these guys are not Jedi.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
Right? Like, it was... As I'm watching this, I'm like, yeah, I want Kanan... Or, I'm sorry, I want Ezra to, you know, go after Kanan, because Kanan's a hero, and, you know, I want him to be, you know, saved. I don't want him to fall into the fate of the Empire. But I'm like, well, but that's not what we've been taught that the Jedi do.
But the Jedi are assholes. We've covered this.
Right. Well, it's a different age. Right? This is a different age. This is not the Clone Wars.
Yeah.
Right? And I want to see how that plays out, because now we are getting the big character from the Clone Wars,
mm-hmm.
Ahsoka.
Right, yeah.
Who turns out to be Fulcrum. She knows, like, you know, we've talked before that Ezra Bridger is the era Bridger between the prequels and the original trilogy.
Right.
Right? But introducing Ahsoka as Fulcrum into this, which, like, wasn't that big a surprise for everyone that was kind of following the rumors.
Well, even they didn't even have to read rumors.
Yeah.
If you're following,
like,
the shows.
Yeah, if you're following the show, it's like, yeah, this is... odds are this is going to be Ahsoka.
Yeah.
Right? But when she shows up, I was just like, okay, wait. Like, the implications of her showing up, immediately followed by the implications of Vader showing up, you know, because the Inquisitor is supposedly dead, and Tarkin's pissed because the rest of the Imperials on Lothal are incompetent,
mm-hmm.
you know, so they have to bring in the big guns.
Right? Yeah.
So they, I mean, literally, like, one scene after the next, they introduced the Padawan and the Master.
Now, I gotta
say...
And
the Padawan... Well, wait. Okay. Before we... The Padawan, she knows the Jedi way. She sure. rejected the Jedi way.
Mm-hmm.
So what is she going to think about these two, for lack of a better term, Jedi idiots?
I don't know. I wish I would have spent 12 episodes with her. I didn't know.
Well. we'll get there. Like...
You know, it's just...
Patience, my young Padawan.
Yeah. Yeah. I just think it's... I guess my problem here is that I get what you're saying, and I understand it.
Yes.
But Kanan's a boring asshole. I mean, that's the biggest problem with the series, is that Kanan is kind of boring, and he's kind of an asshole.
I was not as bored with him as I was.
You used to be.
I used to be bored with him.
Okay.
Okay? But he had... He had one line in the last episode that was like, oh, that's what he's about. He was afraid. He was afraid to be a Jedi. He was afraid to train Ezra. Like, we saw this throughout. Like, it wasn't...
Fear was kind of an undercurrent of the whole was, show.
Right. It was not, like, blatantly telegraphed to us. But, mm-hmm. like, throughout the entire season, you know, he doesn't want to train Ezra. You know, for whatever reasons, you know, he kind of puts it off until Ezra does, you know, a big force move, and he's like, okay, I gotta try to train him. And then when he does try to train him, he's like, you know, do or do not, there is no try. And Ezra's like, what the hell does that mean?
It's all platitudes.
Right? And,
yeah.
And Kanan's like, yeah, I don't know what that means. You know, like, he doesn't really know what he's doing. Right?
Right.
And by the end of it, he's like, you know, they're having the big fight on the, you know, the catwalk, like in Phantom Menace,
mm-hmm.
right? Ezra falls. Kanan supposedly, you know, he thinks that it's, you know, Ezra falls to his death, right? And he's just like, all right, I have nothing to be afraid of now, you know, instead of... Like, I thought that was a really, really...
That was a good moment.
That's I thought that true. Was a really great moment for the season and for Kanan as a character. He's like, all right, I could be pissed off right now and, you know, just kind of go off on this guy because he just killed, you know, the kid I was training who I've grown attached to. But he's like, no, I don't have fear. I've learned that there's stronger something stronger than the fear. There's the Force. And he doesn't, like, he doesn't lash out at this guy and go off on him. Like, he's actually kind of restrained in his attacks on the Inquisitor.
Right.
You yeah. know, I thought that was, for a TV show that we criticized in the past, I was like, okay, I get it now. They had to find their footing.
Mm-hmm.
And... By the end of the season, God damn it! They found their footing.
I'm gonna at this point is a good time to be like. So, when I first watched it, I did come away like wrestling with certain things.
Yeah.
But then later on throughout the day, the more I thought about it, the more it won me over. The more I was like, well, actually, I mean, I think this is a series that's going to benefit from a rewatch. And I think, like you said, they really did find their footing.
Yeah.
And season two is going to be much more interesting.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they've introduced probably the two most interesting characters that we've seen in Star Wars in the last 10 years.
I think that we're going to see here in season two, when the big storyline gets underway.
Yeah.
Something big happens. They'll go, you know, go through the internet.
Yeah.
And it gets on Netflix or something.
Yeah.
that's when I think we'll see people start binge-watching it and start really getting into it. Probably around season 3, I guess.
Sure.
When the first two seasons are on Netflix
sure.
or something.
Sure.
Or Hulu. But, yeah, I think you're right. I think it was successful. I think it did explore some very interesting things. And I, more importantly, I think it expanded the universe.
Oh, totally.
And that's no easy thing to do when you have guys who, literally, guys who just volunteer work weekly, get together and like talk for 2 hours about Star Wars and analyze it from every possible angle.
Right,
like,
right.
I mean, so they have to throw in a little bit of fan service. They have to throw in, you know, stuff like Lando and, you know, various things just to keep everybody going, just sure. to keep it in the headlines, you know?
We may have mentioned it on the show prior to this, but, like, having Billy Dee on the show as Lando, like, first time around watching it, I don't think either one of us were fans of that. Like, it
was that puffer thing.
It was the puffer thing. It was just...
Didn't seem very logical. Didn't make a lot of sense.
There's some characters in that show that seem very un-Star Wars-y. They're a little bit more cartoony than we're used to in the Star Wars universe.
Mm-hmm.
But going through it again, like, there's some level of intellect being told in that storyline. Like, Lando isn't all he seems to be. Like, for a kid's cartoon, like, they're painting in shades of gray, and I applaud them for that. Honestly, rewatching it, I was like, yeah, this isn't as silly as I thought it was. And honestly, Lando kind of comes across as kind of being smarter than the rest of the crew, aside from Hera.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which I thought was pretty interesting. I think
Hera is definitely the strongest. Hera is
the smartest. I think it's a wise, not a wise. I think it's an interesting choice that we're led to believe that Kanan is the head of the crew, but he really isn't.
Right. Like, it turns out by the end that he doesn't even know how the operation works.
Right.
Like, and literally doesn't know how they're connected.
Right. He doesn't know anything, and Hera knows everything. Right, and Hera is keeping secrets from him on purpose,
just in case he gets caught.
There's a lot of subtle things going on. Maybe I caught this on the rewatch, but like, whenever they're on a mission, they use code names. Okay, Spectre 1, Spectre 2. You know, the name of the ship is Ghost. The shuttle is Phantom. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And I may have this wrong, but I believe Kanan is Spectre 2. And Hera is Spectre 1.
Nice.
Right? So, right away, if you're, like, paying attention, it's like, yeah, he's not the number one guy.
Yeah.
Hera is.
Yeah, and I think you can definitely get that vibe that she... I mean, it's a very egalitarian series in terms of, like, everyone... It's not the traditional format. Right. Which is something that I appreciate.
Sure.
It's like, surprisingly, it's not the, you know... The strongest character isn't the guy.
Right.
You know? Your main two characters don't have everything figured out. They're not the leaders.
Right.
Beyond one step beyond that, even, it's not... You're not getting these full backgrounds. Usually, one of the things I really had a hard time with was, like, I don't even know who Sabine is. I don't know where she's from. I don't know anything about her.
Right.
But on WTF the other day, Mark Maron's podcast... Richard Linklater showed up and was talking about the power of just spending time with a character.
Yep.
And about like how you don't really need to know a lot about a character to start empathizing with them just because they're on screen. Travis Bickle was his example from Taxi Driver.
Sure.
Was that you find yourself, kind of pulling for, the Travis Bickle character, the Taxi Driver, despite the fact that he's, kind of insane. He's trying to kill the president, maybe.
Sure.
His political figure. And is offing people on the basis of his own strange moral compass.
Right.
But, like, it's just the fact that you're spending time with this character, their day-to-day life, that you're empathizing. And I see Han Solo's the same way. You're just won over by charm.
That's an interesting point. Like, I'm by no means... I'm not a screenwriter. I I'm not a movie maker.
I'm no hero.
I'm no hero. but, like, I'm obviously fascinated by the format. I'm a movie lover. I love being told stories. And I hear, the critics nowadays that, oh, there's no character development, or there's no...
The online critics,
yeah.
The armchair quarterbacks,
yeah. And that is an interesting point that you make, is like, well, I do know this character just because I spent time with that person,
Yeah.
I just Rebels was, 15 episodes, 16 episodes, 20 minutes each. That's like, 4 hours, 5 hours, like, spent with these characters. I may not know Zeb's background, but I know he's a good creature, and he wants to do good, and he's
an archetype. He's a little bit of a gruff guy, but yeah.
Kind-hearted, and he wants, justice.
Yeah. You know more about him than you knew about Chewbacca.
Right. We don't know a lot about Sabine, but we know that the character, the Empire, did her wrong. Like, what more do you need? We're only 15 episodes into this, right? Supposedly, this is going to go for another 3 or 4 seasons.
And if you want to keep
seasons are going to be twice as long as this season. So, I cared about Luke Skywalker when he was bitching about going to Tashi Station. Well, and I didn't know him very well, but the way he was portrayed in the movie, in those first few scenes, I was like, okay, this is, the person intuitively, the way he's portrayed on screen is like, oh, this is the character I'm supposed to be following.
Well, I think, yeah, and I think an even better example might be just the fact that just to keep the action moving, we don't necessarily have a scene where Han Solo says, oh, back on Coruscant, I used to do this, this, and this. And we save that for the books. Let the other people figure that out.
Right.
This is really just, hey, that's why we're dealing with archetypes.
Yes.
The advantage of archetypes is you can kind of know them without knowing them.
Right.
And you can get the action moving.
Right.
You made a good argument a while ago about this really doing a good job paying homage to George Lucas's mentality with the original trilogy, which I really poo-pooed initially, but looking back on it, they really do keep the dialogue quick, fast, they keep the action moving. By the time they figure out how their machine works, I would say towards the second half of the first season, they really have it down in terms of things are just moving fast, action's happening, we're keeping it light, dramatic things can happen, but no one's getting scarred, it's just, we're moving forward.
Right.
And I think that's really where it's at strongest. And I think that now they've kind of built the mousetrap, and now I'm excited to see how it works in season 2.
Just to kind of add on to it and maybe reiterate, but like towards the second half of the season, what's really going on with these characters is we're learning about them by how they are reacting to the situations they're put in. Right. We're not finding out their backstory, but we're finding out about who they are because of the predicaments they're being put in. We know that Sabine is an artist, but we also know that she's kind of cocky and kind of has little respect for the Empire, and she kind of taunts them every step of the way. We know that, Zeb is, the big guy who just likes to crack skulls, mm-hmm. not harm the people he cares about, but, if people are putting the people he cares about in harm's way, he's not going to stand for that,
Right.
Kanan, we know a lot about Kanan. Probably the most about Kanan. We've had a novel that kind of started off introducing him, but we know that Kanan is fearful. He's fearful of losing Ezra. He's fearful of training Ezra and not doing doing it right. Like, he's fearful of...
Do you think he's aware of Anakin Skywalker? Do you think he's aware that Anakin was a bad seed and that's what killed all his friends?
Well, I mean, that's going to be the big question moving forward into season two, right?
Like, right.
Let's just get the fanboy moment out of the way, right?
Mm-hmm.
Fucking Ahsoka Tano shows up, right? Like, we're all suspecting it, but she shows up, and she's, like, 15 years older. And, like, how awesome was that? Come on, right? Come on.
I didn't care. I didn't care for the way she looked, I'll be honest.
See,
I don't like the face. I mean, I look forward to seeing how the model actually moves in season two. This was a shaky opening, though.
I've overanalyzed her look since I've watched the show. Her facial markings are different. Mm-hmm. I'm curious about that. Like are they tattoos? Do they grow? They're different from the original character model, right? The markings on her head thingy, whatever, are different, okay. Right? She has a different jewelry or whatever she wears on top of her head thing. It's more samurai-like. Supposedly, she, even though she lost both of her lightsabers in the Clone Wars, she has two new lightsabers. They're supposed to be white. First white bladed lightsabers to kind of portray that she's neutral.
Nice.
Right? She comes off very, very kind and serene.
It's funny how you said that, because my interpretation of it was, I put it on Twitter, my reaction to seeing her was I felt kind of like, the Indian and One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
I didn't understand your reference.
Well, it's just like, well, have you seen One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest? Like she's lobotomized. Like,
oh, I
it's
didn't
like,
think
oh, what
all.
Happened to you?
Oh, I didn't think that like, at all. I didn't think
yeah,
that at
I
all.
I wanted to smother her with a pillow. I was like, I'm sorry, Ahsoka. I'm sorry they did this to you.
Really? Oh, I didn't think that at all.
No.
I didn't think that at all. I thought it was a very interesting progression for the character. I think that...
Well, it's only... Keep in mind, it's only, like, less than 10 seconds.
Yeah, right.
It's less than
but
10
I
seconds.
But I also... Like, we've seen less than 10 seconds of her in a vision in the Mortis trilogy.
Yeah.
And that character model was not well done.
No.
Right? The older Ahsoka character model that younger Ahsoka sees in the Clone Wars. That, maybe for that race, is accurate. And I know I'm splitting fanboy hairs here, but, like... The new character model for her, I feel, is a little bit more, it's softer, you know, it's less alien.
We don't get to see a full model either.
No.
We're just seeing a close-up, really.
Right. But I feel like, I don't know, I got a sense of, I was put at ease seeing that character. It's like, okay, this is a character that... Not only do I love from the Clone Wars, but she also has a level of respect, a level of knowledge that, you know, our goofball Jedis that we've been following, you know, our wannabe Jedis that we've been following for the previous 14 episodes, like, they don't have. And I was like, okay, this is interesting.
I think it's a good dynamic. I think it's good that she's in the show. It does make me a little... I do kind of wish she'd been in the show from the beginning, but I understand we're making new stuff. There's new ground, less baggage. Yes. That makes sense.
And like I said, like...
Some people don't want to jump onto a show that has six seasons... A character that has six seasons behind them.
Yeah, right.
Like, I'm not going to jump on Legend of Korra because I didn't watch Airbender.
Right.
So I got to watch Airbender before I get Legends of Korra.
Apparently you don't, but I tried to get through Airbender and I couldn't do it.
And that's the thing, is they say you don't have to, but some people like me are going to want to.
Exactly.
So I understand the wanting to start with a fresh start. That makes sense. But that said...
Which is going back to what I said earlier. Like, when they cut to the last time we see the good guys on screen, it's not on her.
Yeah.
It's on the characters we followed for the previous, you know, 15 episodes.
Right.
Right? We don't see her. Like, it's not her story.
No.
Nope. This is not her story. You know, and we cut to the second reveal. I don't like to say the second reveal because, honestly, I think there was reveals prior to this that I was more excited about than Ahsoka and Vader being revealed.
Okay. Right? What's the other reveal you don't want to say?
Well, so let me just say, they cut to Vader,
yep.
Right? Vader getting off the shuttle, and I thought that was, like, I thought that was very, trying to think of the right word. It was nice storytelling. Like, you're being introduced to the Padawan, and then you're being introduced to the Master.
Yeah.
In a different form. And, like, immediately, my head is just like, well, where's this going to go? Are they going to confront each other? Is she going to know that's Anakin? No. Does she know that Anakin turned to Vader? Does she know Anakin's still alive? Does she know Obi-Wan? Does she know Yoda? Like, what does she know? What doesn't she know?
And she's, but like you said, it's not her story. We're not going to be focused on that.
No, but, I mean, this is stuff that, I mean,
my
this
first is Star question Wars, was
eventually it'll be addressed.
My first question was, how are they going to animate Vader?
Well,
because like we get is a very like,
it is of, true, yeah. Right? It's interesting that they've taken more of the Ralph McQuarrie approach to Vader's helmet.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a little bit more samurai-ish. It's not a direct interpretation of the. The helmet that we've seen.
Yeah, it's a little more of the Marvel comic style, too. I saw a little of that inspiration.
I'm totally happy with it. Also, Vader seems a little thinner. Yep. I've seen the character model kind of expanded on in the concept art in that. He seems a little skinnier.
And you knew he was going to have to be because he's going to have to move fast.
Yeah.
And that's always been the trouble with Vader. I've always wondered what they're going to do with him.
Right.
Well, like you see it in comics sometimes. They draw him when he's like fighting someone, and it's supposed to be like fighting and flipping and stuff. Right. Always looks awkward.
And I look forward to this, something that I picked out of Dave Filoni's interview.
Mm-hmm.
By introducing Vader, what we're getting is we had the Inquisitor, we've had Kallus, we've had, you know, the whatever, the mayor, senator, whatever her name is.
Oh, yeah,
right?
Yeah. The headdress person.
And we've had the two bumbling idiot Imperials, right? All with their faults, right?
Mm-hmm.
What Filoni has said is by introducing Vader, Vader is an immovable object. He is a force that cannot be defeated.
Okay.
So we're not going like what he's kind of alluding to is the fact that Vader isn't going to, like, the Rebels can't win against Vader.
Plot-wise. Because and it's interesting because this is a space where Filoni, I think, is comfortable playing because that was what the whole Clone Wars was.
Right.
Like, we knew where these characters began and ended.
Yeah.
And so now we're starting to get to a point where we're back in that place.
Sure.
Not for everybody. I mean, I guess that's a large part of why they want to introduce all these new characters.
Yeah.
So that we have at least a few new people that have some consequences, some stakes.
Right.
You know, they could die now, they could never die.
Right.
They could show up in The Force Awakens. So.
Yeah.
That's probably the biggest argument for all new characters. But, I don't know. I guess to me, it's one of those things where it's like, this is one of those weird things where it's like Disney's being a little more ginger and handling the property they paid for all that money for better than maybe I would have. Because to me, it's like I would have written the show that was going to make $1 trillion right out of the gate. But sure. It's all about Ahsoka versus Darth Vader the whole time.
Yeah, right.
But like that's not necessarily...
It's restraint. It's restraint.
Yeah, that's which is, I guess, refreshing.
It is.
Because I don't want to read fanfic that I wrote.
Sure.
And like... That's also not sustainable. It doesn't grow the world.
Right.
It's more fan service.
Right. Well,
so
I would allow me to sidetrack us for a second. I was telling you about my other viewing endeavors over the weekend.
Yeah.
Adam Sandler movies.
Yes.
Right. Like I watched a couple of them. I've been listening to another podcast called The Worst Idea of All Time or The Worst Idea Ever, right?
Mm-hmm.
Two guys from New Zealand.
Oh, okay? Yeah, I've heard of this. Yeah.
Are watching, or were watching, they've already completed it, but are watching Grown Ups 2 every week for a year,
mm-hmm.
right? Once a week for a year, right? Kind of a shitty movie, right? Not only a shitty movie, but a sequel to a shitty movie, right?
Right.
They had not watched the original Grown Ups, right? They're just like jumping in and be like, yeah, we're going to watch this movie, and we kind of know it's a bad movie. We're going to see if it's going to drive us crazy.
Okay.
You know, I was telling someone about this, and they're like, why are they doing it? And I'm like, I don't know, because they can.
They hate themselves?
Right. I don't know why they're doing it, but they did it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of backfired on them, because I was like, having watched or listened to, you know, 24 episodes of this, I'm like, you know what? I want to watch Grown Ups 2. They made me want to watch Grown Ups 2 instead of, mm-hmm. even though at the end of every episode, they're like, I don't want to watch Grown Ups 2.
Little did you know, that podcast is a Happy Gilmore production.
Oh, God, I hope not. Right?
You just got marketed.
But I watched it, and then I watched another Adam Sandler movie, and the reason I watched it, because I wanted to watch something that I knew going into it how it was going to end. Like, yeah, it's cliche, and it's, you know, nothing surprising here, but sometimes you just want to watch something that's, you know, like, you don't have to think about. Like, oh, I know exactly, you know, who this person is going to end up with at the end of this, you know, 5 minutes into the movie.
Now, you're not comparing Rebels to this, are you?
No. That's what I'm saying. Is like, if Rebels gave us that, then it's no better than an Adam Sandler movie.
Ah, yes. Right? Understood. Right.
Right? But they're not giving us that. We as a collective fan base think that they should, you know, turn right. They veer left.
Right.
Right? And that's fine. You know, we as, you know, Star Wars fans have years and years built up to expectations of what we think happened between, you know, Revenge of the Sith and, you know, Attack or A New Hope. You know, we have years and years built up of EU thinking we know what happens after Return of the Jedi, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, they can repeat that. We know what happens. They can play to what we expect. Or can they be like, well, it's more interesting if we tell this story.
And I think that's a very good point to end on, because we were talking about this earlier today, the Gen 1, Gen 2 fan.
Yeah.
I think you were quicker to embrace this because you had already had years you lived with the OT, and then you had to come to accept the prequel trilogy. So yes. You've already kind of gone through this thing. Make this point.
All right.
So whereas I had less years to live with the OT before the prequels came on.
Yeah.
And then, but I had years to live with that before Rebels comes on. And now it's like you just said, this is the new thing. This is the new thing they're serving. They're expanding the universe.
Yep.
If George Lucas had decided to be like, oh, why don't I just make the exact same type of three movies I did for prequels, I did the original trilogy, we wouldn't have had this whole political element and this whole, like, we wouldn't have understood all this kind of gray shades he was trying to paint with in that
right.
one.
Right.
And this new thing, yes, you could stop right now and say, well, this isn't my Star Wars, and be left with six films in the Clone Wars, or six films, or three films.
Right. As we found out from your friend PJ,
mm-hmm.
that's all he has.
That's all he has to live for.
Yeah.
And,
that's sad.
But
some people, that's what they decided, that's a cutoff.
Yeah. Right? And I had to face that crossroads here where I looked at the whole series as a whole, and I was like, you know, I found a spark of hope.
A spark of rebellion.
Maybe a new hope. And I thought to myself, I was like, you know, this could get something really good.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, right now, I think it's decent.
Yes.
But I think it's going to grow into something really good.
I think so, too.
And so this is the new thing. I'm embracing it.
Because all right.
Because if you don't, what else are you going to do? Like, it's like, well, then I guess I don't like Star Wars anymore. Like, right. You know.
I guess I'll wait for the next movie.
Yeah.
And that's all I have.
But I think this is actually going to grow into something.
I think so, too. So. I think so, too. I did, I know we're trying to end this. I did want to say I did have two moments that really, aside from the Ahsoka reveal and the Vader reveal, I thought there was two moments that really impressed me.
Mm-hmm.
The line that the Inquisitor says before he falls to his supposed death, you know, that there's some things worse than, you know, death.
Yeah.
Thought that was a great line.
Nice little Vader tease.
Yeah, I thought that was a great, great Star Wars moment. The other one, to me, I thought, and I've rewatched it a few times now, I think it's more exciting for me than Ahsoka and Vader being on screen.
Mm-hmm.
The moment when it looks pretty hopeless for our Rebels team in their two TIE fighters, and out from hyperspace comes the three blockade runners with Chopper.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And I was just like, okay, we've had our callback to, or our homage to the Phantom Menace with the lightsaber battle. Now we're getting our homage to Star Wars, A New Hope, with Han Solo coming in at the end, right there to kind of save the day. We have, you know, three blockade runners, you know, a fan favorite of mine, that ship, the, you know, the first ship you ever see in Star Wars, mm-hmm. fan favorite. You have three of them come in to save the day, kind of kick ass, and then take off right away. You don't know who's piloting them, but, like, you know that it's the good guys because
that's
the shape of the ship.
And thematically, that was a really good moment, too, where the whole time it's kind of rumors, this rebellion. We don't actually know if there's actually any tight-knit rebellion or not.
Right.
It's always kind of just rumored, and it's the first concrete evidence of, nope, there is a larger rebellion, and they do care about this Splinter Cell.
And it, as we said, it's storytelling through action.
Yeah. Right? Yes. Agreed. Yeah, I think this is going to hold up very well. You know what? Damn it. I'm trying to put the button on this episode, but you keep bringing up good stuff. I also just like how the last three episodes, they seem to like point for point. Like when we were talking about this point for point idea for us going like point, counterpoint, good versus bad.
Yeah.
We were talking about this before I saw the last three episodes.
Yeah.
And those last three episodes kind of do the whole counterpoint thing where there's so many in-story meta references to, like, fan critiques, I felt like.
Yeah.
Like, we've had a problem with Chopper the entire season.
Right.
He's like a malfunctioning, stupid droid.
Right.
They end up taking in this other droid through a whole circumstance.
Yes.
And the droid is, like, seems to be, like, very functional and good at its job.
Yeah.
To the point where Zeb's like, we should keep him. Yeah. They have two droids. And it looks like they're going to close out on it. And then Chopper, like, knocks it out of the ship and, like, kills it, essentially.
I was kind of disturbed by that scene.
Yeah, it's a little disturbing, but it's also, like, I took it as, like, the crew that makes the show being, like, yeah, we know that Chopper's an annoying shit. He's meant to be.
Yeah.
Like, he's not going anywhere.
Right. And it's
funny.
I did kind of feel like...
I chuckled.
I did feel like Dave Filoni was just, like, Dave Filoni, I don't think, would ever say it this way because he seems like a pretty kind-spirited person, but I feel like that ending there was Dave Filoni saying, fuck you, fans.
Yeah.
Chopper is the hero.
Yeah. And there was just a lot of that throughout a lot of, like you pointed out earlier, a lot of moments where you realize things about the characters where it's like, oh, I thought it was this and it's that.
Yeah.
And it was like, okay, you know? Yeah. So it kind of diffused a lot of my arguments, so that's why, you know, my arguments were probably...
There was also a great moment with Tarkin.
Mm-hmm.
The Star Destroyer he's on is basically going down in flames.
Yeah.
And the officer comes up to him and he's like, we need to evacuate. And as a Star Wars fan, you're waiting for Tarkin to say, evacuate in our moment of triumph.
Right.
And he doesn't say it. And I was like, oh, thank God.
Yeah.
Thank God he didn't. That wasn't a throwback to the original. Like,
which I think they're also aware of. That, like,
no, they totally
they totally kind of abused a little bit of the callback stuff. And that was for a few episodes.
Yeah.
And I think they're purposely showing restraint in that.
Yes. So.
So it's a show that's learning and growing.
It's learning, it's growing. We're really, I mean, again, I'm forgiving it its faults for what it's given me in the last, you know, finale of the show, or of the season, really. We're really just kind of, I think we're just, you know, touching the beginning of the show, really, and I think it's going to really take off in the second season. I'm really looking forward to the preview that they're going to show in April at the Celebration.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not entirely sure. Is that when the season starts, too? Like, I don't know when season two starts, but I know that...
I can't tell because it's on this Disney XD. How do we know how anything works?
I don't know.
This new cord-cutting world, I don't know.
Yeah. I guess we'll just have to watch SpongeBob until then.
You know, it is funny. There's a lot of shows on the Disney XD where I'm like, I wonder what this is.
Yeah, I know, right?
I'm like, looking at this Gravity Falls. I'm like, that animation looks kind of cool.
Oh, I watch Gravity Falls. Oh, is it cool? Actually, it's kind of cool.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. Disney XD.
Also,
plug.
Rick and Morty is supposed to be incredible.
Is that on there?
I don't know.
No.
I just heard about it.
I thought that was like a grown-up show.
It apparently is.
Yeah, because isn't it a Dan Harmon production?
Yeah.
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 Okay.
All right, folks. I think we've done all we can with Rebels for season one.
Yeah, so Rebels, bumpy ride, but hang in there.
Yeah, bumpy ride, but I think it pays off. Pays off at the end. Stick with
it. There's a happy ending.
There's an ending, and it makes you want more, which is, I mean, what more can they give us? All right, folks, I think that's all for tonight. I'm going to go and watch the last episode again.
Yeah, I'm going to go read all the new comics that I've embraced this new canon.
Oh, yeah. A little teaser for next week.
All right,
folks.
Talking Star Wars.
Not talking Star Wars.
Well, talking Star Wars most of the time.
Yeah.
This week we did.
Sure.
All right. Bye. Coming like a rhino. Tables turn. Suckers burn to learn. They can't disable the power of my label. Def Jam tells you who I am. The enemy's public. They really give a damn. Strong Island. Where I got a violin. That's the reason. They're claiming that I'm violent. Never silent. No dope. Getting dumb. Nope. Claiming where we get our rhythm from. Number one. We hit you and we give you some. No gun. It's still never on the run. You wanna be an S1. Grip I tell you when. And then you come again. You know what time it is. MP's the president. Pulling out my ray gun. Zap the next one. I could be a shogun. Soft and smooth, I ain't with it. Hardcore, raw bone like a razor. I'm like a laser, I just won't phase ya. Old enough to raise ya, so this will phase ya. Get it right, boy, maybe I will praise ya. Playing the role I got sold to. Voice my opinion with volume. Smooth, not what I am. Rock, cause I'm a man. No matter what the name, we're all the same. Pieces in one big chess game. Shower boy, P.E. our crew, not singular. We wear black wranglers, we're rap stranglers. You can't angle us, I know you're listening. I caught you pissing in your pants. You're scared of missing us, the crowd is missing us. We're on a mission, y'all. Yo, Chuck, yo, yeah, man. Yo, you got him running scared, man. Terminator X. Showing up in EFFACT, other known as Effect.
more time.
Bring
Chuck.
That beat back,
bring
man.
Bring that beat back. Bring the beat back.
Y'all want to hear that beat, right? Bring that beat back.
Bring that
One,
shit back.
Two,